All of the gameplay in the background of these videos are side missions from Pandora and Promethea, played on True Vault Hunter mode, which means that there will be no spoilers for the game's story. So you are a brand new member of the Moze Gang, or maybe you're just thinking about registering. It might be easy to look at Moze and go, she's just a character with the mech, that's all it is. You couldn't be further from the truth. We're going to go over the Iron Bear mech, of course, all of the different guns that you have, the augments, the variations, but mostly going into each of the skill trees. Shield of Retribution, Bottomless Mags and Demolition Woman to show off her very unique playstyles, and she is incredibly good in each of them. But much like everything, there are a few other areas that you need to watch out for. In case you know absolutely nothing about Moze, unlike the rest of the cast, she only has one ability that you can choose from. That is summoning an Iron Bear mech, which has a fairly long cooldown, and as you're in the mech, you have a good amount of health, as well as a fuel gauge where when you use abilities, you will replenish that resource as soon as it drops to zero, you will be ejected from the mech. Moze initially has three weapons that you could choose from. You have two gun slots on your mech, and you can mix and match or run two of the same weapon if you wanted to. Each of the skill trees has a primary weapon that you get at the top of the tree that you can equip whenever, but as you invest talents into these trees, you will unlock different versions which we'll go over shortly. The first one is the railgun, which fires electrified high-velocity projectiles that deal shock damage. These hit hard, but as you've seen when it comes to fuel, it uses it up very quickly. Not to mention, it's a very accurate shot, so if your aim's not the best, be careful when using this. Next up in the Bottomless Mags tree, you have nice straightforward miniguns, which are capable of firing sustained rapid fire. Firing for longer periods causes the minigun to overheat, rendering it inoperable, and it seems that the more you're likely to overheat, more fuel gets used up. And finally, in the Demolition Woman tree, you have the V35 grenade launcher, which is a semi-auto grenade launcher. Its grenades are not affected by Moze, but these are very different to Moze's equipped grenade mode. They're very different, they just do explosive damage, but much like all of the other characters, you have augments that can improve these abilities further. As you invest into the tree on the left-hand side, these are the augments for each of the primary weapons. We'll go over the augments for these weapons first, before we go onto the secondary weapons that you can see on the right-hand side of the tree. Looping back round to the railgun, you have Hell on Rails, where it now fires superheated rounds that deal incendiary damage, but have increased fuel drain per shot. More damage, more risky though. Capacitive Armature, when railgun hits an enemy, it chains to nearby enemies, dealing reduced shock damage for more targets. So if you come across a group of enemies with shields, you do have a few elemental options at your disposal. And the final augment you can have for a weapon is the Corrosive Sabot Round. The railgun now fires a specialty round that deals reduced damage and explodes after a short delay. It has reduced fuel drain and the magazine size is increased from 1 to 2. You can fire it more, each shot uses less fuel, good for more sustained fire approaches. Moze can only equip one augment per weapon, but let's say you're running two railguns, you could have one that fires the electricity rounds and the other weapon could fire the corrosive rounds instead, so you can mix and match depending on what situation that you're in. You don't need to have the same weapons doing the same stuff all the time, but there are some talent trees that actually give you more damage when you use the same weapon. That's in the Bottomless Mags tree, alongside the minigun, so let's go over the augments there. Let off some steam. Minigun deals more damage as heat increases, and can be fired for longer before overheating. Better for sustained fire approaches, which pretty much sums up Bottomless Mags as a skill tree, as we'll go over shortly. General Winter, you now fire cryo rounds, which reduce heat gain and fuel drain, but they deal reduced damage as a result. And finally, you have exploding bullets. The minigun fires explosive rounds that deal increased splash damage, but its fire rate is decreased. Going into the explosive Demolition Woman tree and the grenade launcher, the first augment that you can get is shaped charge. Direct hits with the V35 deal increased damage, and that's all it really is. Musical chairs. Occasionally, the V35 fires a singularity grenade that pulls in nearby enemies before exploding, and that is every 7th grenade that you fire. Then lock and speed load is the final augment. The V35's reload speed is greatly increased and it now has a 5-round burst, like you're seeing on screen. So those are all of the primary weapons with the 3 augments you can include on each of them, but like I mentioned, if you're looking on the right hand side here, as you're dedicating points into the skill tree, you unlock more versions of weapons that really suit the playstyles of each of the skill trees. We started with Shield of Retribution, we'll go back there. You have the Bear Fist. It's a pneumatic-driven fist that deals massive damage to a single target at close range. So it's basically the melee option. Those secondary weapons also have augments of their own. So what can you get for the Bear Fist? Well, you have Wild Swing. Whenever Bear Fist hits an enemy, it deals random bonus elemental damage to that enemy and all enemies nearby. Going further down the tree, you have Closer Distance. Instead of punching, Bear Fist now launches its fists forward. It grabs enemies at greatly increased range, dealing shock damage and pulling them back to Iron Bear. Finally, you have Shock Hammer. The Bear Fist is now capable of sustained rapid fire punching. Additionally, Bear Fist has reduced fuel drain and deals bonus shock damage with each hit. You'll see me just pummeling a poor target on screen as an example. In the bottomless max tree, you have the Salamander, which is a nice flamethrower that deals incendiary damage, I mean obviously, to enemies at close range. The Salamander does have infinite ammo, but it does drain fuel with use. What can you do with a flamethrower in the bottomless mags tree? First one is fuel economy. Reduces Salamander's fuel drain. Additionally, your movement speed is increased after damaging an enemy with Salamander. This doesn't affect your damage, however, so this is really good as an option. Chemical warfare. Salamander now deals corrosive damage. Additionally, Salamander's melt damage is increased by 50%. Turning it from fire to acid. And finally, Molten Raw, the Salamander Burst fires 3 projectiles with increased fuel drain, the first of which leaves a large incendiary area like you're seeing on screen. And finally, what explosive weapon can you get in the Demolition Woman tree? You have the Vanquisher Rocket Pods, which is a rocket launcher capable of rapid firing volleys of unguarded explosive rockets. What can you do with a rocket pod? The first one is active tracking. The Vanquisher Rocket Pod now fires homing rockets and has increased reload speed. Hold the action button down and aim it at enemies to designate up to 6 targets. Releasing that fire button launches a volley of homing rockets at the designated targets. Option number 2 is target softening. The rocket pods deal greatly reduced damage per rocket, but fires in a 6 rocket spread. Additionally, enemies hit by the Vanquisher rocket pod rockets, man that's a tongue twister, take increased damage from all sources by 15%. But they deal 74% less damage per rocket. Then you have Hammer Down Protocol. What a great one to finish on. Instead of a volley of conventional rockets, the rocket pod launches a single rocket with a nuclear warhead, dealing massive radiation damage. So those are all of the skill trees, the weapons, and examples of the augments of what you can do with them. You can mix and match whichever ones you want, so long as you dedicate points to the specified skill trees. But seeing as I just mentioned them, let's go over the playstyle in each of the skill trees. But before then, we should probably talk about the elephant in the room when it comes to Moze. How does the Iron Bear mech scale with her leveling? Now, just full disclosure, I'm not level 50, but I am a pretty high level on her now, and the scaling is actually really good. It's fine. Even on all of the abilities, you can do quite a lot of damage here in using miniguns, using your railguns, your grenade launchers. When you spec into those certain areas, those weapons do, on average, more damage than you would do outside of the mech, which I think is important. You want to feel like when you get into the mech, you are doing more damage and it's more like an ultimate ability, right? As opposed to doing less damage when you get in there. That would just be wrong. But scaling feels fine. I do intend to do a video with Moze at level 50 to sort of talk about how good she is, how it scales, how worth it I suppose it would be. But at this point, I can safely say that it's all looking pretty good, because all of the playstyles in these trees are significantly different from one another. I wanted to start with Shield of Retribution. Much like a lot of the Vault Hunter skill trees that we've gone over in the past couple of days, there are a few skill trees that often get overlooked because they're based around survivability and just don't seem as exciting as the other ones. Shield of Retribution is that for Moze. There's a lot of focus here on keeping yourself alive, but really, you do a lot of damage, and I think this is one of the most balanced skill trees out of all of the Vault Hunters, meaning it's pretty good anywhere, especially boss battles. It's very similar to Zane. In the first couple of tiers of this tree, has a lot about keeping your shields active, increasing your maximum shield as a whole, damage reduction. Nothing that exciting, right? But you get some nice synergy between two talents. The first is Thin Red Line. A portion of Moze's health is reserved and cannot be restored, but her maximum shield is increased by that same amount. Like you're seeing on screen, I'm at full health, but it's been reduced to a certain amount and that health has been added to your shield. Why is that important? Why would you ever want to do that? Well, it pairs up nicely with Desperate Measures. Moze's gun damage is increased depending on how low her health is. The lower her health, the greater the increase. So it's a good amount of damage that you're getting from being relatively low health. Not to mention your shields are a lot better, meaning that you can keep yourself alive more. There's a lot of talents here, reducing recharge delay and increasing shield recharge rate. And you have a talent here as well, when you jump jump into the Iron Bear mech, your shields and your team's shields will start recharging instantly. There's quite nice supportive stuff in my Which Vault Hunter Should You Pick video. I kind of said that Moze isn't great in a group. I take that back because I forgot about drowning in brass. Every time you kill an enemy, you get a stack of drowning in brass. For you, your fire rate is reduced, but gun damage for yourself and your team is increased by a good amount. 20% per stack, 3 stacks total. Increasing your damage by 60% is quite a lot, isn't it? So I'm very sorry for missing it out completely. Scoring a critical kill stats your shields recharging instantly. You gain a stack of it for every kill. Every stack gives you maximum shield health and gun damage. 2% gun damage per stack with no stack limit. Makes it really good for proving grounds or mobbing or leveling at the later levels. The only drawback really is the Iron Bear weapons. Especially early game, Railgun is one of those weapons that you use and half your fuel is gone. But you are seeing versions like I'm playing on screen where you can stay in the mech quite a good amount of time, and it's really good if you come across like an armored target, you don't have a corrosive weapon, that's fine, just equip the corrosive round, jump into Iron Bear and do the damage then. I often found myself using Iron Bear more like a Primal Rage in Overwatch with Winston. I know I use these really bad examples, but bear with me. Where you're really close to dying, so you jump into the mech, your shields start recharging, and you have a new health pool in your mech, and if that gets killed, you just get ejected from it. You're at full shield again, you should be ready to go. That's why I like her in boss battles. Not only could you do a surprising amount of damage, but also you have great survivability for you and your team, which I really do like. If you're not interested in the bottomless mags playstyle of get a high mag gun and never reload, and you don't really care about explosives too much, then go for Shield of Retribution. It's the most balanced, and it might not be the most exciting, but I have a feeling, certainly when you get to level 50, you don't have specific class mods or legendaries, this is a great one to farm Mayhem Mode, Proving Grounds, those specific areas. So don't knock it till you try it. My personal favorite, actually. Let's tackle bottomless mags Moze next. All about increasing your ammo regen and making it so you don't really need to reload that often. Of course, you still have to reload, like guns that I have on screen that are really strong. I don't have to reload it as much, but I guess most importantly, I don't really need to go to the ammo machines to restock all of the time. Which makes it really good for, I guess, stuff like the Proving Grounds, where on certain characters you can be stomping because you have a really good SMG and you're built for that, but you get to a point where you just run out of ammo, and then everything grinds to a halt. That's just not going to happen with Moze. You've seen from the gameplay, I do get downed a lot, and that's because you don't really have much survivability. It is all based on increasing your magazine size, your fire rate, your critical hit damage. You could shoot and sprint at the same time. You could also do a little bit of fire damage, but in regards to other elements, you don't have all of the options. That's a problem for Moze anyway, but I did want to sort of reaffirm that it's kind of the same in this tree. You do have fire rounds with the money gun and ice rounds, corrosive with the salamander flamethrower too, but outside of the mech, you don't really have too much of it in fire damage, so you have to rely on elemental weapons. Speaking of weapons, you do rely on having good weapons quite a lot in order to do damage here. Like, as I mentioned in the Witch Vault Hunter to Pick Guide video, she is the warrior from World of Warcraft in the sense of she is very reliant on the gear that she has. If you have good gear, you're going to do quite a lot on Moze. In fact, you might do the most DPS out of everybody. But trees like this require certain class mods and require strong weapons that you don't really need to reload much, such as the Butcher. You hit hard with this tree, and with the capstone you are constantly regenerating ammo for the currently equipped weapon. You really don't need to worry about it as much as you would on other Vault Hunters and in other trees. So if you get this and you pair it with some of the early tier talents of, say, Shield of Retribution, or you make some form of hybrid build between the two, you could do quite a lot. That's another thing that I like about Shield of Retribution, actually, is that it synergizes well with both Bottomless Mags and Demolition Woman. It's a very situational build, I suppose it would be, but there's no situations that stand out for me where this is really bad. It's just you need to take care of yourself health-wise, you don't have your shield regening as much, so you kind of do need to rely on other trees in order to sort of cover up that pitfall. But it's a really fun tree with the right weapons, you will just never need to reload, and you could do a big chunk of damage. More so, I believe, than Shield of Retribution, but of course you miss out on a lot of damage mitigating. Finally, we have Demolition Woman, which is based on doing a lot of explosive damage. If you like using grenades, this is a really good tree. Your grenades have a chance to crit. You can also increase your grenade carrying capacity on top of the stuff that you'd get from the SDUs too. You you can gain health back from the grenades, and you even have a chance to return a grenade whenever you deal splash damage. So you pair this up with a nice torque weapon or just heavy explosive weapons as a whole. Not only do you do a lot of damage because it increases those kind of weapons and those kind of attacks, but you get your grenade back, meaning that you can spam it more to do more damage. You never run out of grenades, it feels. So it's a really fun playstyle if you just like to cause as many explosions as possible. This is more dependent on, of course, your grenade, how good it is, your weapon, if you have a really good torque gun or something else. It's really reliant on that, but even if you don't have a weapon that does explosive damage, you do have the capstone, which is whenever you deal gun damage, there is a chance of a secondary explosion centered on the target. So even if you've just got a random assault rifle that doesn't do much more than that, you can still cause some explosive damage, which is greatly increased in this tree. There is also a big focus on the mech. You have trees that give you additional armor and increase your maximum fuel. You have talents that reduce the action skill cooldown time, meaning that you have it up more often and you can use it more than any of the other trees. It's certainly the best for mech uptime, and the weapons that you have, the grenade launcher and the rocket pod, are some of the strongest when it comes to just all out damage. Of course, this sucks when you have specific boss battles where you need to hit critical hit spots because they're massive. You lose out on that accuracy, and it's only really good close to medium range. Anything farther than that, again, you miss out because you are not the most accurate version of Moze that you could be playing. I feel that the playstyles of Moze really speak for themselves from the gameplay that you're watching. It's very one-dimensional in that sense, but if you know what you want and what you want is Moze, then that's great. You know, not everybody needs a very complex character that nobody really understands yet, like Zane. Moze is fairly straightforward. I do think that Shield of Retribution has been slept on by a lot of people, but if you like explosive damage and want to play that, then you can do. If you want guns that never have to reload, you can do. If you just want to play a gunner, you're going to get all of that here. She is great across the board, even better for boss battles, no matter what they are. You have a great Iron Bear mech for survivability and the damage that you can do. But if you don't want to be shoehorned into a particular playstyle, then that's where Moze can be a bit dicey. And I think Demolition Woman as a whole kind of sums that up. If you don't want to play like you're seeing on screen, it is a bit awkward to try and get around it. You have other talent trees that you could use that are much more flexible, but if you don't want to do explosive damage, there isn't too much here for you. What stuff should you watch out for if you want to play Moze? All of the stuff that I mentioned, it's very one-dimensional if you're not interested in it. One area that I haven't touched on is her mobility. It's the worst out of all of the other characters. You don't have any talents that if you kill something, it increases your movement speed as an example, so you tend to not be as quick on your feet as the other Vault Hunters. Iron Bear can be super weak against some badasses and bosses depending on how you spec, but also you can rely on it a bit too much, with Iron Bear having a pretty hefty cooldown early game, which can be really awkward. It does get better over time, but it's still not as fast as the other ones. You are very reliant on the gear that you get. I say that about everybody, but Moze is definitely the worst example of this. And you're not really flexible with your elements either, other than the Iron Bear augments that you have with the weapons, as we've gone over in this video. But I think Moze is the one I want to dedicate more time into post-launch, especially once I get to level 50 and the game opens up a bit more. But I've been able to do a lot of Mayhem mode stuff, a lot of Proving Grounds as Moze, and do it without breaking a sweat, whereas people like Zane can struggle in certain situations because of particular areas, the gun that you have, whatever. Moze, because you can just jump into the Iron Bear mech when you need to, it's a nice way to play, honestly. So if you are interested in playing Moze, I hope that this helped. I hope that this prepared you for what to expect when you go and start playing this character. That's all of the guides as well. Be sure to check the playlist to see if there's any other guides that you want to check out. Be sure to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video. And also keep an eye out for more guides. What kind of stuff do you want to see now that we've gone over each of the Vault Hunters? Thanks for watching, guys. Take care. I'll see you very soon.